Today's episode is proudly brought to you by Ambiji. Hello, my name's Rebecca Tapp and welcome to Decoding Purpose. The word purpose has worked its way into part of our everyday vocabulary, not just in business, but also in our personal lives. So where do we begin with such a big concept? And what are some of the steps we can take to explore our purpose and apply it to our lives? In Decoding Purpose, we unlock the minds of on-purpose activists, innovators, entrepreneurs, scientists, creatives, spiritual thinkers, and everything else in between. Welcome to the podcast, Decoding Purpose. Hello, and welcome to today's episode of Decoding Purpose. After a number of weeks diving deep into conversations of corporate and collective purpose, this week it's time for a change of pace. And that is why today I've chosen to step into purpose as a spiritual pathway. Now, with regards to the activation of purpose, I have pondered whether I would choose to dive into the spiritual components, given many of my interviews have had a core focus on the more tangible qualities of personal purpose or organizational purpose. That said, stepping into my truth, I cannot separate the activation of purpose from the spiritual journey it presents us with. Like a practice of faith, the pursuit of purpose is also a practice. All of that said, I do want to say that this is not a conversation that is about any particular religion or belief, as that, like the pursuit of purpose, is something that's deeply personal. Your faith or practice may be nature, science, dance, or meditation. It may also be that you embrace a chosen religion and prayer is your practice. What I want to focus on today is that, regardless, purpose comes from an ability to step through the parameters of ego and enabling ourselves to experience a greater sense of contribution, the kind of contribution that comes through us rather than being from us. And with that in mind, our spiritual practice can and does enable us to gain a clarity of purpose. Without further ado, today's guest, Sarah Brooke, is the creator of The Space In Between. Sarah is a Reiki master, a soul medicine therapist, a ritual weaver, and ceremonialist. The essence of Sarah's work is about guiding people to ground the sacred in their everyday life and remember their true nature. Sarah and I share a lot of philosophies when it comes to the concept of soul purpose, and today's conversation is a beautiful exploration of all things soul, chakras, meditation, spirituality, and some of the practical ways we can activate this facet of our purpose. This podcast is perfect for those of us who find ourselves stumped when someone says, just follow your gut or trust your instincts, and where to begin with understanding what our hearts and souls can have to say when it comes to life's big questions and decisions. Sarah believes we are living at an extremely important tipping point of human history, that our consciousness and awareness is expanding rapidly, and that the choices that we make now will have a ripple effect on how we evolve as a species. We are all being called to action the guidance our souls are giving us. The world as we know it is changing. It isn't going to go back to the way it was. And Sarah's commitment to assisting others in connecting with their true selves and soul purpose is so clearly evident in today's conversation. Welcome to the podcast, Sarah Brooke.
Thank you so much for having me, Beck.
I am so excited to be decoding not only purpose, but soul purpose with you today.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's been, I think, quite timely that you've asked me to speak on this today, because I feel like I'm going through a redefining of what my purpose is at the moment. So I'm looking forward to chatting further with you about it.
Oh, and I look forward to unlocking that evolution. So as a practitioner of the soul, I'm very excited to ask you a question that I kick every episode of this podcast off with, and that is whether you think purpose is fate or a choice that we make.
Ooh, that's a juicy reflection. I think it's actually a mixture of both. I feel that we have a soul blueprint that is very much within us. But I also think it's a choice and part of the evolutional process of whether or not we choose to live that or if we're choosing maybe a different path, or yeah, I think it's a mix of both.
A lot of people say that, and people from all different types of, you know, different parts of the world and different experiences. So I was very interested to get your answer on that one as well. So to give you a little bit of background, you and I met when I first moved to Melbourne a few years ago. And at that time, I started a meditation class with you, which I absolutely loved. I know in that time you've practiced as an energy healer, a chakra dance teacher, and that you've also created your own healing practices, exploring themes around visioning, creativity, rituals. And I recently did a workshop with you while I was pregnant, which was amazing. Now, I know even for me to engage in this conversation today as a part of the Decoding Purpose podcast, I really needed to, I guess, step into a level of authenticity and go, you know what, I'm really going to dive into the spiritual on this topic. I'm really going to step into my truth. So here we are having this conversation. But the reason I say all of that is because my question for you is around, how did you land on your purpose to do this work? And taking that one step further, how did you give yourself permission to express your truth with, you know, boundless energy and build a career from what some may be, you know, some may consider to be, I guess, a little bit more out there?
Yep, absolutely. So for me, it was definitely something of walking this path and doing this work was nothing that I sought out. If you'd asked me as a teenager what I wanted to do with my life, I probably wouldn't have even been able to answer because I was unclear, but it definitely wouldn't have been, oh, I want to be a healing practitioner and do ritual and ceremony, because at that point in my life, I didn't even know that that existed. So for me, I think much like many people that walk a similar path to what I'm walking, it came through crisis and breakdown and chaos and me going from living a life, I guess, that was very following what I guess is expected. I was ticking the list of what I probably should be doing as a young girl going to uni, choosing a really safe career with business marketing, and ended up landing in quite a good corporate job to start with quite early. But there was something within me that just felt incredibly lost. And I had a very good ability of putting on a veneer on the surface of everything's fine, I'm all good, but underneath just had this deep darkness and hole and void where I started to really question, you know, is there more to life than this? And worked my ass off during the week, and then found the dance music scene in Melbourne, which was very mixed for me because in many ways it was a sense of finding community, freedom, a somewhat of a sacred space. That was where I really explored dance as well and music, and found that it opened me up into these other realms and other spaces of myself and connection with others where I was like, wow. But then quite quickly fell, I guess, into the shadow of that industry with partying a lot, taking a lot of drugs. And so was really operating at this very, you know, highly doing yang phase of working really hard during the week, partying equally hard on the weekend. And, you know, a couple of years of doing that just landed me into burnout, where a lot of the anxiety, depression, and eating disorder that I was moving through culminated to this breaking point where I was like, oh my God, I can't keep doing this. And the catalyst was actually my parents separating when I was in my mid-20s, because it went from me, even though I'd been living out of home for years, but they were this structure that was behind me that I knew it didn't matter how messy or lost I was in my life, that I could always kind of retreat and go back home to the family home. So when that fractured, it caused me to start to seek a grounding within me that wasn't there. But the beautiful thing in reflection to that time was that it did start getting me honestly saying to people, look, I'm not coping, I'm struggling here. I started working with a therapist who was, you know, the catalyst of so much growth and change for me. And she set me on a path of saying, Sarah, there's nothing wrong with you. You just actually have to start living life on your terms. And this is where this link of purpose started to come in, because she started to nudge me on, you know, you're not living your purpose. When you start living your purpose, all of these other things that are causing you grief, concern, and stress are actually going to fall away. So she put me on a path of starting to journal write, starting to meditate, which organically really led me to the right teachers at the right time. Soon after that, I did my Reiki 1 training as well. And all of a sudden, these pieces of the purpose puzzle started clicking in, where I was like, oh my God, I can start feeling more like a whole human being, because there's this whole aspect of my identity through my sacred nature, my spiritual nature, my energetic nature, which is actually such a huge part of who I am, but hadn't been available to me consciously, that started to become conscious. And it was so healing, so amazing. Definitely, you know, lots of challenge, as those soul initiations do ignite, but so worth it over the long term. And after going through such a shift like that, I just knew that I had to share the same tools and techniques that had supported me with others. And that's how I've ended up where I am now. And it is still like there's still pieces that keep on kicking in, and new offerings or techniques or ways that I work with people, it continues to evolve. But that foundation, I guess, of consciousness expansion and helping people with their awareness, and part of that, and a big part of that, is allowing people to connect into their energetic nature, to have the confirmation and validation that it is something that's real, even though you can't see it or it can't be validated in a way of a lot of the Western model works. But for so many people, and so many people I work with, it is that missing piece of the puzzle, so that they can start then living on purpose.
That's such a beautiful story that you've shared with us. And, you know, I think from your story, the one thing that stood out for me then was just the power of that question, asking yourself, do you need more? Like, is there something else? And do I feel fulfilled? Am I living in alignment? Whatever that is, that the pursuit of purpose asks us to begin to step into that level of fulfillment. And, you know, as you said, it's not necessarily easy. It's a journey, but it's one that's got a level of congruency about it.
Definitely. And I remember the catalyst for me of what really, I think, started that emotion was finding out my parents were separating, going out on, I think it was like a 3-day bender. Now my body just aches. But anyway, and driving home at the end of that, just being on that kind of come down spiral and just dropping into the darkest space I'd ever been. And it was definitely a suicidal space as well. Not that I got to the point of actually actioning any of that, but the thoughts were there. I was like, you know, there has to be more light to life than this. Otherwise, I'm checking out. And when I think back on that, I think that was this first call and, I guess, prayer to something higher than me, going, oh my God, I need support, I need help, I need clarity, I need guidance. And that really set this call for purpose in motion. It was, you know, recognizing that where I was at wasn't right, didn't feel right, and surrendering something to something higher than me for that guidance. To set in motion everything that then rippled from that time.
So I research all of my podcast guests, and in your case, we've now been kindred spirits for quite a few years. That said, every time I do research, I'm always fascinated to unlock new perspectives on the nature of purpose. And today, more specifically, we're diving into soul purpose, which is why I loved your biography. And I was having a look at your biography, and what you said is we are living at an extremely important tipping point of human history. Our consciousness and awareness is expanding rapidly. The choices that we make now will have a ripple effect on how we evolve as a species. We are all being called to action, the guidance our souls are giving us. The world as we know it is changing. It isn't going back to the way it was. Now, I have about a million questions on this one statement.
Yes.
However, as a starting point, what exactly do you mean when you refer to this important tipping point in human history?
I really feel that we are at the precipice of a species of either evolving or becoming extinct. And in order for us to evolve, we have to adapt to the changing times. And I feel like part of the major puzzle that is missing in terms of, you know, how are we going to adapt to changing climate? How are we going to change to technology and AI technology coming in and, you know, revolutionizing total industries where a lot of people aren't going to have to work? Is this consciousness piece of the puzzle that in order to evolve, it's tapping into our consciousness, our awareness, our spiritual nature, our energetic nature, because that is where the wisdom is of what we need to do moving forward. And it's that frequency that the innovators, even the people that are working with technology or whatever new designs and new industries are coming into our humanity and our collectiveness, is from people tapping into that space, whether or not they actually use that language or they might have another language that they use about it. But it's that, you know, the frequency of the new coming in. And for me, that is accessed through our spiritual nature and our energetic nature.
So the second part of my question was that I loved the idea that we are being called to action the guidance of our souls.
Mm-hmm.
That sounds to me like soul purpose.
Absolutely.
However, before diving into the guidance component, how do we begin to define the soul? One of those questions.
Well, the name of my business is The Space In Between, and that name came to me when I was looking for a name for my business and set an intention before bed one night to ask, you know, what do I call my business? And I woke up in the middle of the night with the name of The Space In Between. And so for me, to access the soul is through the space in between. So it's those still spaces, the still moments, the dreaming of. Another way that I can describe this as well is that we've come into form as these beautiful seeds that hold these blueprints. And I think I know that you've referred to it sometimes as, you know, the DNA consciousness and what is intrinsically part of us. I feel that soul is part of that, and it is the part of us that knows exactly how we need to grow. It is the part of us that's connected and unified to everything in existence, that is guiding us forward, that is the evolutionary pulse. It's the part of us that's beyond our mind, because our mind is this incredible researcher that wants to understand and box and confine things and creates and weaves these stories. But the soul is the part that's beyond that, that's the canvas that's holding everything of us, if that makes sense.
So if we then take the soul concept or the soul identity and look at that in partnership with guidance.
Mm-hmm.
Let's say I'm someone who's craving a deeper sense of meaning and connection in my life. How can I begin to tune into this soul energy in order to unlock my purpose or my divine mission? And what tools and techniques can I use to hear that wisdom or guidance?
Absolutely. So, I mean, the number one tools for that is through meditation. But what I want to say to that, though, is that sometimes when people hear, oh, if I meditate, I'll, you know, connect to soul or connect to purpose, it's sometimes not as quick as just sitting down and meditating and that will come through. But the meditation space allows you to start to tune into this part of you that is beyond the mind. But the ways that we can meditate, there's infinite ways that we can do that. So I think I'm similar to you, Beck, in that sometimes for me, moving my body through dance is a form of powerful meditation that is more powerful than me sitting stationary and waiting for some guidance or answers to come through. One of my brothers, for example, he won't sit down and meditate traditionally, but he goes surfing. And for him, when I speak to him about how he feels when he's surfing and being connected to nature, being connected to the rhythm of the waves and having to be so present in that moment is his form of meditation. I've got another friend who loves riding motorbikes. So for him, when he's in that space on his bike, he can come into such a serene place of presence. That is when he often receives his greatest downloads or insights or clarity about what he's needing to navigate. So I think it's whatever people need to do to get out of their minds, and to know that you can do that through really joyful and pleasurable things. Like it might be sitting beside a campfire or going and soaking in hot springs or whatever it is, just to get out of the everyday thinking, groundhog day routine and that limited mind to connect into something that is infinite. You know, a lot of the time I'll suggest to some of my clients, if they're in a really closed space where they're really needing to connect to purpose and higher perspective, I'll say to them, you know, at night, I want you to go out and just look at the night sky, look at the stars, look at the moon, and it helps to give them that perspective of infinite and that there's something so far greater that is ruling us and moving through us in every moment. Or other things I might say is go for a hike and sit at the top of a mountain where you can see 360 degrees all the way around you. And often those insights from soul can be so much more clearly heard in nature.
And look, I think your advice is so practical because, you know, I think many of us would have had times where we've had that idea drop in while we're having a shower. You know, I was chatting to someone the other day who said she gets her best ideas on a plane because it's the one space where she's disconnected from technology. Yep. So she kind of allows that space for deep thinking. And, you know, so I love how you frame meditation as something that happens in our day-to-day life and in the normal moments, as well as the moments where we might, you know, find a sacred space and sit on a pillow and traditionally meditate.
Absolutely. And I remember reading something about Albert Einstein once that it's in an interview that he's done somewhere that he knew when he was solving a lot of these amazing equations and finding out like the mysteries of the universe through all of his research was that he would get to a point where he knew his logic mind had taken him as far as he was going to go. And then he would know that he had to get out of the mind. So he would go and have a bath. He'd have a nap, he'd go and play with his nieces and nephews or go for a walk outside, and that's where he got the solutions and the answers to so much of his profound work. And it's always stuck with me because, I mean, he's, you know, would definitely be one of the most brilliant minds of recent times, and he's kind of leaving those keys of, you know, it didn't come from the mind, it was something else that he was tapping into that provided those answers.
So I mentioned earlier that I met you doing a meditation course with you. And yes. I always remember that time because I just moved down to Melbourne. I remember sitting at my desk at home that day and all of a sudden I had this like voice drop in going meditation class. Now I've practiced spirituality for a long time. Mm. So the idea of having like a spirit around me or a guide around me wasn't foreign, but this was the first time I had so clearly heard a message and had something drop in like that. And as a result, I jumped on Google and I think you were about 2 minutes down the road from my house and the rest is history. Here we are today. But the reason I bring up that example now is because if we're discussing guidance and the soul, was that voice my soul? What's your experience of spirit guides and other beings? Do we have other support around us as we pursue a life of purpose?
We do, but I think the number one, the most important being that is guiding us is us, a higher, if you want to call it the higher self, the soul self. I think sometimes, particularly in my industry, there can be a lot of transference and a lot of giving power away to other beings or guides or angels or animals or whatever it is, when the majority of the time what's actually happening is that it's someone's higher wisdom that's guiding them, their energetic body that is tuned into the fabric and the web of life, that's tuning into something that hasn't quite physically manifested yet, giving them that guidance. So in terms of empowerment and sovereignty, I think, and this is something that I hammer home to so many of my clients, is to take ownership that higher wisdom is almost always us. to that, though, I do truly believe and have had direct experiences with that there are beings, energetic beings, guides, and also our ancestors that are very much present to support us and guide us forward. But I also know that there's also beings and also ancestors that have their own agendas, and their agendas may not necessarily be in alignment with our agendas. So as with every relationship in our life, having that discernment is also really key, and I think so important when it comes to working with energetic realms, of not just assuming, oh, if I'm feeling this energetic being, that it's safe and friendly. And I don't say that to scare people, but I just say it of, you know, use your discernment and your instincts of, does this guidance of what's coming through actually feel right to me? And using the same discernment as you would if you were talking to a mentor or a teacher or a colleague, if they're sharing information and tuning in and feeling into yourself and going, yep, this feels right to me, or I don't think this feels right. And so that's why I think really it's us that's giving us the higher wisdom, and to own that is really important.
So I've been doing a little bit of research into the connection between neuroscience and meditation, and some of the research I found claim that there's emerging evidence that meditation might cause neuroplastic changes in the structure and function of brain regions involved in regulation of attention, emotion, and self-awareness, which I thought was pretty amazing.
Yeah.
As somebody who regularly meditates, what is the experience of meditation like? What actually happens?
Meditation for me is that intimate relationship that I have with myself and all levels of my being. So the part of me that is the thinking one, the part of me that is the feeling one, the part of me that is the infinite wise one, and also allowing my consciousness to expand and connect into things like, at the moment, I'm really loving working with plants in a very deep way and connecting to the consciousness of a plant and learning what wisdom and guidance that plant might have for me to come into resonance with. So meditation, I think, just to summarize, is an intimate relationship with my true self.
And with that in mind, how do we define what that true self is? And to give you context around that question, I'm just, you know, thinking about the different times I've sat down to meditate, and, you know, you've got those inner voices chattering, and sometimes, you know, it's like a chorus line in there. How do we distinguish that internal chatter from the essence of our true self or the essence of our soul? And how do we quieten those voices in order to hear the soul?
I think the first thing is through cultivating a relationship with the part of us that is the presence, that is the watcher and the observer, and to identify of what is just the thinking mind, what is a story, what is just part of maybe something we've picked up from our ancestral lineage or trauma from the past, comes down to feeling, and feeling in the body. Because when we receive these transmissions or these aha moments from soul, you feel it within every cell of your being, and it's just this deep embodied knowing, as opposed to the chitter-chattering of the mind, which can sometimes create maybe excitement or anxiety or fear. When it's soul, it just feels right.
So would you say that knowing is experienced in the body and energetically as well as in the mind, to distinguish it?
Definitely. And I think that's a really key point. The body is really the barometer of the soul. The body is the temple of the soul. And I think sometimes, you know, particularly with more traditional forms of meditation, and this is why I love dance as an embodied practice, because it actually gets you in the body. So I have quicker transmissions from soul doing dance or qigong or walking outside or stretching, then some of the more traditional forms of meditation can take us very strongly into the observer. But then if we're not grounded in our body, we can miss the transmissions or get lost in the thinking mind or disassociate from the body itself. So I think it's key that the body is involved in spiritual practice.
Well, that brings me to my next subject, being the chakra system. So yes. One of our shared passions is, of course, the exploration of the chakras. And
definitely.
I think the chakras are an imperative to a conversation about soul purpose, because mm-hmm. I personally believe that if we're looking to manifest purpose, it's so important to understand the chakras as a system, as an anatomy of the spirit. But, you know, for those of you who may not be spiritually minded, as a process or a blueprint for decoding the personal experience we have in our lives. So for our listeners, are you able to describe what the chakras are and the role of the chakras in supporting our soul purpose?
Absolutely. And so one of the more grounded examples or analogies that I can give in terms of the chakra system and life force energy. So life force energy, you know, there's many different terms across many different cultures of what that is. So Chinese will call it qi. In India, it's prana. In English, it's life force energy. And so this energy runs through the chakra system. And the chakra system, each of the seven chakras, is much like a computer program that governs different areas of our inner world and our outer world. So if you're wanting to change anything externally to come into the inner programming and rewire it from that space is the only way that we really make any lasting change. But how the life force energy works is it's much like it is really the true currency of the universe as opposed to money, but it is like money in that we can make good investments of our energy that give us a good return and an abundance and vitality and flow. Or like money, we can make bad investments that might leave us bankrupt or leaking energy. And those choices of where we're making them sits in the chakra points. And it's that choice of, am I going to make a choice that's in alignment with what my instincts is telling me to be true for me? Or am I giving my choices away to how I've been conditioned? Or am I making kind of bargaining tools of if I give this, I get that, and a lot of the programming that many of us have come in with. So the chakras give you this diagnostic system to go into and go, okay, if I've got issues around work, security and survival, that sits in the base chakra. So I can start to work on things that I know support the base chakra. So the base chakra is like the roots of the tree. It's our anchoring into the physical world. It governs our physical body. It looks after security, survival, food, money, how we fit into a tribe and the collective consciousness. So there's things that really support the base chakra, such as spending time outside in nature, eating a good diet, making sure you're well hydrated. And so there's things that we can do when we understand, things of the chakra system that when we do that, it's actually quite simple to implement, but it has this vast ripple effect on all of the areas in our life that the base chakra then governs. So it's such an intelligent and amazing system that really allows people to move out of victim consciousness, out of blame, out of waiting for someone or something else to come and save them, and go, you know what, I'm going to take 100% responsibility for my energy, for my system, and then that is how we move forward into this true liberation, and then we're free to really live the purpose that's coming through us.
And I mean, look, we could talk all day about the chakras, and I think for anyone, wanting a more detailed description of the chakra system, maybe go and check out Sarah's website, and I will provide the links in the show notes from today. But you know, for those of you who are familiar with the chakras, I just want to note that I think we're often so conditioned to work with the flow of energy up into the universe when we're working with chakras and this idea of, you know, meditating to reach enlightenment, where when it comes to purpose, I actually think a big part of the process is about grounding and about connecting with the universe in order to bring in those great ideas and in order to bring in that inspiration. But to bring an idea into the real world, we need to be connected to the real world.
Definitely.
And I think that's so important to note in a conversation about what it is to create with purpose.
Oh, my God. It's imperative and key. There is so much material out there of how we can move the kundalini or the life force energy from the base up, and not as much out there. I mean, it's a two-stream system. Mm. There's earth energy that's coming up, and then there's the cosmic spiritual energy that's coming down. And in order to be a whole, complete, fulfilled human being living an earthly existence, which is what we're here to do, that downwards current is so, so important.
So we've spoken about meditation today. We've spoken a little bit about the power of dance. And I also know that you're an incredible sound healer. So I'd love to unpack with you a little bit around the power of sound in healing and working with the soul.
Absolutely. Well, oh, sound is one of my greatest loves, and music, I think, has always been the balm of my soul and the gateway to my soul. Ever since I was a little girl, I would often shut myself away in my bedroom and play whatever music I loved and would dance and sing along to that. And actually, I was thinking about this the other day. I used to listen to a lot of Madonna and Janet Jackson, and when I've listened back to the lyrics or even just the rhythm of it, it's really sexual. And I thought it was interesting for me as such a young girl to be really resonant with that style of music, but it makes so much sense to me now in understanding rhythm and sound and harmonics, is that that sexual energy and creative energy are one and the same thing. And music really allows us to access the harmony of the universe. I mean, there's so much amazing research out there of the harmonics of the universe and the pulse of the earth and the frequencies of the earth, and even simple things like working with a drum and a 4/4 beat is the same beat of the heart. So when we intrinsically hear it, it just reminds us of being in our mother's womb, and there can be such comfort with that, of allowing us to really come back into our own sovereignty, our own space, and our own truth. Listening to music, like certain pieces of music, our mind will make associations, and it can help us with emotional releases. Or, you know, if we're going through a breakup and we're listening to lots of songs that was other people have written when they're going through a breakup, it can make us feel like we're not alone. Music and sound can be such a connector into unity consciousness and what connects us all. And so for me, as I mentioned earlier in our talking, for me in my early 20s, when I was feeling really lost and was looking to connect to tribe and to try and find my community, because the community that I'd been hanging out with in high school, I'd really outgrown and was feeling, you know, a dissonance with. And it was through my love of dance music at a time when the scene was really thriving that I was able to connect to other like-minded people. But I just remember having these moments and being on the dance floor, and this is when clubs were just dark, there wasn't a whole lot of lights, like you would just go there and listen to this beat and this rhythm and this pulse, and you'd be dancing with a whole group of other people. And what I loved about dance music is I wasn't necessarily having to talk to anyone else, but you would feel the community all coming together with a shared intention, and the power in that, the liberation and the wildness of really it allowing you to have the experiences of connecting to something that was much higher than me, that was that primordial current of life. So it's so expressed through sound and vibration. And so over my 20s, really exploring that, and I used to do a lot of singing in clubs with DJs, and I would want nothing more than just to hide up in the DJ booth with the DJ. I didn't want to be seen. I didn't want to be doing any performance. I just wanted to sing and sound over the music, because even back then I could see that there was something that was going on with the frequencies that were allowing people to come into different resonances with their body and within themselves that really fascinated me. But it got to the end of my 20s and the whole industry started to really shift, and I was getting pressure from a lot of club owners and the people that I was working with that they wanted me to perform more, they wanted me to mime and do all of this stuff that just didn't sit right with me. And I was also starting to do a bit of studio work and just would always have this block. If I was in a studio, I couldn't sing and sound exactly the same way I could in a live environment. And that was also around the time when the space in between my healing business started to take off and my focus just shift entirely. Mm. The idea of singing in clubs had lost its romance. And so the singing and the standing and the music kind of took a back seat and I stopped paying any attention to it. And it was actually when you told me about chakra dance that it started to creep back in, because I thought, no, there's something more about music, sound and dance and song that I'm not quite identifying just yet. And chakra dance definitely put me on a journey of embodiment and working with sound and more world music, and this recollections and resonances started to come back in. And then I found through that, and then also through some of my one-on-one client work, the urge to want to sing and tone over my clients came in. And I was like, oh, I resisted it for a little while and then started to explore it. And it's been particularly, I'd say, over the last 2 years, a lot of that's really clicked into place of understanding how powerful sound is for shifting energy, but also how powerful it is for connecting people into their hearts, and for women and for men, their creative centers, so the womb part of us. And to also create spaces of unity consciousness. It's done so powerfully with sound and music. And I think that's why there's, you know, festivals are so popular and why so many young people really seek out that space, because we're all seeking what we used to do in ancient times of gathering as a tribe, listening to sound, frequency, using song to transcend and go into altered states and receive wisdom. It's so powerful as a cultural technology, I truly believe.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, I was actually watching a documentary that's on Netflix at the moment called One Strange Planet, and mm-hmm. they were talking about the celebration of death in life. And I can't remember where the culture was or what episode this was, but what they did is all the salmon would come in to the water, to the edge of the river to breed. And then after they breeded, they would all die. And this would happen over like a week long period. And the tribe, like hundreds of people would come during that period and they would literally dance for, and they still do to this day, they would dance for like 2 or 3 days, literally until they were exhausted, to celebrate this whole idea of, you know, of death and coming together and exploring creativity and sexuality and mm-hmm. the whole life cycle, and that the dance was a part of that journey for them. And it was so beautiful.
I'll have to check it out. And that just reminds me as well, I read something recently that scientists have finally realized part of the reason why whales beach themselves sometimes is because whales operate off sound and sonar frequencies. So they'll sing to each other to understand where they are in relationship to the ocean. But they've found out that that gets disturbed by some of the submarine frequencies. So it's humans in the ocean, of course, which is causing that imbalance for whales to kind of lose their tracking, but they track themselves through sound and vibration and song.
So, look, I want to dive into this subject a little deeper because, again, you know, for someone listening to the podcast today who hasn't had much experience of soul work, of healing, or how sound engages healing.
Mm.
Firstly, I think sound is really interesting because it's an energy that we all know is real, but that we all agree we can't see, yet we feel it. So I think it's such a beautiful example of energy and energy as we experience it in physical form.
Mm-hmm.
So how then, what happens when a sound frequency enters our energetic field? How does it influence it?
Okay, well, we can come back to the chakras for this as well. Mm. So when you imagine that the chakras have got their own harmonics or their own notes. So if they're working in the way that they've been designed, there's a frequency, like a note, or if you want to imagine, it's a color frequency that's coming out of each of those chakras. So when they're pure and clear, it's like a beautiful orchestra is playing, everything's in harmony and balance and creative growth and flow. If there's a disturbance in that energy field, so say, for example, someone's holding onto a lot of grief in their heart and so they're having trouble feeling or they're having trouble moving forward in their life, they're constantly looking back and they're stuck. If they were to listen to a song that works very much on the heart frequency, they might listen to a piece of music and then all of a sudden start crying and they're not sure why they're crying. It's because that sound frequency is going into their heart, allowing the heart to clear out the dis-resonant frequency so that their heart's coming in tune. And so that's something that sound and music and song can do. And, you know, song and music's been around on the planet for thousands and thousands and thousands of years. And from a DNA level, we remember certain songs and melodies because they're the same songs that perhaps our ancestors used to sing, or there's certain songs that when you sing, it creates your breath to do different things through your body. So it's just fascinating, but it really is helping us to tune back into our true soul song, I guess is a good analogy of how to explain it.
That's a beautiful way of putting it. And
yeah,
to loop back into purpose for a minute, the reason I'm sort of digging into this a little further is because if I'm listening to this and I'm wanting to tap into this soul wisdom in order to be able to unlock my purpose or get clearer on my purpose or simply to connect on a deeper level, I can almost think of my soul song. If my soul song is harmonious, if it's in alignment, I will feel that level of expansion and open myself to purpose, opposed to not having that level of harmony, that my energy, in the same way when, you know, an instrument is off key, we're gonna feel off key. And that will in some ways inhibit our purpose from flowing.
Absolutely. And so for me, as I was explaining before, when I went through that first initiation into my purpose, the dis-resonant frequencies that my body was giving me were anxiety and depression, were just these calls of knock, knock, you're not living on purpose, knock, knock, you're not feeling right in your body, you're feeling heavy, you're not feeling in alignment. And it was anxiety and depression that really sought me out to get help.
So that was the off key.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
Wow, interesting. I could talk all day about this subject, but I'm going to dive back into purpose again. So when I talk about purpose, I often talk about it using a term called the equatorial zone, and I think you'll like this one because the equatorial zone is a term in biology that literally refers to the space in between.
Ooh.
And I heard a neuroscientist refer to it as like the space in between the land and the sea or the edge of the forest. Yeah. Or if we look at it through the lens of, say, a caterpillar becoming a butterfly, the equatorial zone is the cocoon. So we know in the cocoon that this is a space of deeply magical transformation. But the other thing about the cocoon is it's kind of pretty uncomfortable in there. It's dark, it's sticky, my wings haven't quite grown. And I think this is a really good example of what it is to maybe experience the dark night of the soul, where whilst on one hand we're going through this deep transformation to become a butterfly, on the other hand, it's really hard and not comfortable and not certain and none of the things we as humans like if we're wanting to feel comfortable. So what is your advice for people who might be going through these, you know, deeply transformational times but really difficult periods in life?
Yeah, and I think that I always go back to the caterpillar and butterfly analogy as well, but because the butterfly, there's nothing of the caterpillar that exists in the butterfly. So in that metamorphosis is such a shedding and a death period combined by birth. But another analogy that I'll use in addition to the cocoon is the womb, when we're going through a dark night of the soul, we're literally back in the womb. And so I often, you know, one of the areas where people often come and find me, or their inner knowing guides them to me, is that when they're going through big life transitions, big questioning of who they are, where they fit, I will always give them the analogy of, you know, just understand that it's so dark for you right now because it's as if you're back in the womb and you just need to rest and be still and allow the metamorphosis and to trust that your body and your soul knows what's going on, even though those points of transition and the dark note of the dark night of the soul are so full on for the mind. Like, I remember, you know, obviously in my mid-20s going through a dark night of the soul, and that happened again for me when I was around 33, and I'm turning 38 this year. And so when it happened at 33, it really rattled me because I was like, well, I'm on purpose. I've got this amazing business. Why the hell am I feeling depressed and anxious again? And it was because life was just taking me on this other deep initiation. And so my anxiety and depression came back, but I've almost changed my relationship with depression now because I've seen, because it kind of started coming back again last year as well, is that that depression energy was pushing me into the darkness so that I could go through this metamorphosis and to let go of the expectations that my mind had maybe had on what I should be doing with my life or how it should look, and allowing that to be stripped so that the life that I'm meant to be living could come from that space.
Sorry for my pause there. I'm just absorbing the last part of what you said, because it makes me want to lean into some deeper questions around the role of depression and how these things, how does depression and anxiety serve us? Because we're facing such a big mental health crisis in society. Absolutely. You know, 45% of people in Australia anyway, and more than likely around the world, are dealing with a mental health condition. Yep. So what is the message? What are we really, can we really learn from that experience about soul purpose?
I think a lot of the mental health issues that we're facing as a society is a result of spiritual crisis.
Yeah.
And I think it's actually going to get worse. It's going to get so much worse before it gets better, because this is where that missing piece of what is our relationship to consciousness, what is our relationship to the collective consciousness, how are we identifying the shifts that are going on? Like, our generations have gone through more change than any others that have come before. Like, that's epic, but so hard on our nervous systems. We're also generations that are dealing with adapting to technology, phones, the internet, our minds being so engaged in a very different way. So many people are disconnected from their body, their body's wisdom, so disconnected from the earth. So we've got a real crisis of not spending enough time out in nature. I think we all know if we spend a day out in nature, we always feel better than we're not. And that's because our body's needing that balance and flow. So a lot of the mental health is that we're getting stuck in the mind, but also this spiritual crisis of not understanding the alarm bells or the knock knock from the soul self going, hey, this isn't working. Something needs to be paid attention to, or there's old trauma that I'm holding that needs to be held and integrated. And we're just not connecting the dots. I mean, we're all trying to do the best that we can. But I think mental health, because it's been my journey, like my mental health and issues with mental health was my initiation into my spiritual and sacred nature. And for so many of my clients, it's the same. So I think that this is one of the major pieces of the puzzle, but I think it's going to become exacerbated and worse. And I, you know, I've talked to one of my beautiful mentors, Sharon Bolt, around this a lot, and she's further iterated that she really sees it as well, of people going through spiritual crisis or really opening up to their energy bodies or their consciousness expanding, and them not having the context in our current society of what's actually going on, because it can be really scary when you go through a spiritual awakening and you don't have a context or a guide or someone that's gone through it before you to go, hey, it's okay. You might feel like you're in psychosis, but it's just your mind going through a metamorphosis. You're going to be okay on the other side. I think there's this famous article that kind of has done
the
rounds.
You're just going a bit nuts over there, but you'll be fine.
Yeah. And then it's finding the balance, because sometimes psychosis is actual psychosis that needs to be treated
absolutely.
And needs meds and all of that. But
absolutely.
Then there's also people going through these huge spiritual awakenings where they're tapping into other dimensions and beings and, you know, really opening up to the quantum field. And I remember reading an article once that when, you know, we're in ancient times, if there were children or teenagers or early adults that would go through this, they would then be matched with the medicine man or the medicine woman of the tribe, because they were wired that way to be someone that walks between the worlds of the physical and the energetic and guided.
Yeah. I mean, and gosh, to me, it feels like such an important time to return to tribe and to return to some of those rituals, those practices.
Definitely.
To understand the role of the medicine man.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's one of the things that I love the most and I'm enjoying the most with my work at the moment, is creating group ritual spaces where we come together with a shared intention, and journey with, you know, sound and music to bring us together. But one of the things that I've loved with group work ever since, you know, you and I'd worked together in group work, is that shared vulnerability, that when we're held in circle and people are actually being honest of, oh my God, I had a really hard week, or I'm questioning everything about my life, and then, you know, having this ripple effect of everyone else in that circle or group going, oh my God, me too. And then the shared compassion and relief, where it's like, oh my God, I'm not the only one feeling like this, is so healing. And then the group comes together to create the transformation, as opposed to the individual feeling like they're doing it all by themselves.
So how can we then bring rituals back into our modern worlds?
I think the life transitions that are organically, I guess, already celebrated in our culture are birthdays. There tends to be a ritual around birthday. There's rituals around birth, and then there's rituals around death. And they're really important rituals to have. So rituals can be very powerful when you're going through a life transition. So, you know, for example, you've just had your beautiful girl. So when mothers are birthing their first child or whatever child, they're going through a deep life initiation. So having that honored by a ritual or a ceremony, by either a mother blessing or a baby shower or a christening in whatever religion or faith or spiritual practice, can be a really important step for the tribe to come together and to mark that that individual or that group of individuals has gone through a change. So you can do ritual and ceremony either by yourself. It's extra powerful when you're gathering a group together. You can do ritual to celebrate, or if you're wanting to call something new into your life, if you're wanting to let something go, it doesn't need to be complicated. And I think it's important that whatever ritual someone is practicing is that it feels authentic to them, that they're not necessarily going to something and they're borrowing it from maybe another faith or a lineage or a country that's not really in resonance with them, because it's not going to have as much power of them literally just sitting and going, okay, I'm going to mark this time of my life to go into myself and my truth, to maybe go out in nature, whatever it is. It can be very simple, and often the more simple it is, the more profound experience is going to ripple from that space.
So do you have like a very simple ritual or tool that you could share with our listeners if they were wanting to create a ritual around bringing their soul purpose into conscious awareness?
Yes. So let me just feel into this. Working with dreams and the dreaming is one of the most potent ways to start to get clarity over soul vision, soul purpose, in a very easeful way, because everyone seems to have very busy, full lives, work commitments, family commitments, and can sometimes struggle to find the time, whereas everyone has to sleep. So I invite the listeners to start to dedicate their dreaming time to clarifying their life purpose. And what you can do, this is a really simple ritual, is to have a bowl or a glass of water beside your bed at night, to put an intention on a post-it note of when I'm sleeping, I wish to connect in the dreaming to my soul family and to get clarity of my soul purpose. And then you put the post-it note under the glass of water or the bowl of water. Water is a conduit that can be programmed, and it helps to open up the dreaming consciousness. And just do that and see what happens. See what dreams you have, see what insights and inspiration or people start to come into your life, because you might not consciously remember the dreams that you're having, but you're going to start to really rewire and access this deep, wise, all-knowing part of yourself.
Love that. And I love how practical it is as well. Yes. Thank you.
I'm all about it being easeful, simple, grounded, and relatable to the times that we're in.
Like, that's right. And that, look, that's why I love talking to you, because whilst we're talking about very big, expansive topics, the way you talk about it is always so grounded and so simple, and there's always a really great takeaway. So, you know, I appreciate that, and I appreciate that tool to help us to, you know, bring purpose into the world.
Yeah, my pleasure. I mean, it's something that's really important to me, of making the sacred every day is sacred, and grounding that sacredness into the everyday, because that's what we're here to be doing. You know, we're not here for a long time. We're short time, even if we live into being grateful enough or blessed enough to live into our 90s. Like, when I speak to people, they're in their 80s and 90s. They all say, you know, life just goes so quickly. And it's so important that we're honoring each day with that. And so by making it grounded and relatable and actionable, then we're actually going to do it and feel the benefits, as opposed to feeling like we've got to overcomplicate. Because to be honest, the moment we start overcomplicating something, that's the mind. It's not actually the soul at all.
So, as you know, when I talk about purpose, I often talk about it as being like DNA, which you referenced earlier in our conversation. You know, so it evolves, it's influenced by genetics, and it's unique. It's like a unique blueprint. Mm. So, looking at purpose through that idea, I now want to talk to you about the epigenetics of purpose. Mm. Mm-hmm. So while there are variables in the research, some studies are now making links between inherited trauma and our health. Mm-hmm. From your perspective, what are the connections between our ancestors and the experiences we have in our lives, be it our health or the pursuit of our purpose?
It is key, and I'm so excited and happy of the whole field of epigenetics really grounding this, because I've seen it so much with my one-on-one clients over the years, that a lot of their own fears and insecurities, while they're their own, are also a direct result of traumas that their ancestors have experienced. And so for everyone to start to gain an understanding of their own ancestral lineage, either by, you know, there's the great DNA test that you can do now, where they'll give you a loose idea of where your lineage is from if someone hasn't tracked a family tree, and you can start to look at the histories of the countries, of those areas of wars and famines or whatever has taken place there, and then start to referring that to your own relationship with money and resources and talents. But, you know, a lot of the talents and skills and strengths and also weaknesses that we have are a direct result of our ancestry. It's incredible.
And I think it's so interesting just to reflect on that, and to, you know, as individuals, to look at some of those patterns in regards to understanding what might be supporting the pursuit of our purpose, but also Definitely. Understanding what we might need to work through and transform and process that may come Yeah. from that ancestral, those ancestral lines or ancestral patterns, with regards to moving forward and evolving.
Definitely. And so to give a real life example, for me, my lineage is, you know, strong Celtic with Nordic splits in it as well. And so for me, in my blood lineages, there's a lot of alcoholism, mental illness, depression and anxiety. But I also come from a lineage that's very deeply creative. And so the more that I embrace my creative nature, the less that the anxiety, the depression or the addiction would rule me. And also, you know, coming from a Celtic lineage and English stock, expression of emotions really isn't a strong point in my lineage as it is for so many. And so part of that repression of emotion, of not feeling, of not expressing vulnerabilities, is part of the manifestation of mental illness, anxiety and depression in my lineage, and where a lot of the addictions have come from, because addictions will often stem from someone coping with their emotions or trying to cope with their emotions in a way. And so the more that I connected in with my emotional nature, learned how to feel again and to express, again, it helped to ease a lot of the addictions. And so kind of understanding those connections of, okay, well, if I've got this strong creative current through my lineage and I've got a few artists in my lineage that have gone a little bit crazy, okay, so I can learn from what happened to them and try and reweave the lineage in a different way.
So I imagine a lot of this ancestral energy would be passed through the womb.
Definitely.
And as you know, I attended your creation workshop, which has a focus on the profound power of the womb energy when I was pregnant. So given this conversation is very much focused on the birthing of purpose, how as a male or a female can we work with this creative womb energy in order to birth our soul purpose?
Well, again, it loops back into what I was saying before of having a practice or having time during the day and the week to get into the body and into this part of us that is this sacred nature aspect of us, to start communing with it, but also something that can be really powerful and, again, quite simple, is to start creating. And it might just be going and doing a pottery course or knitting a scarf or doing some freeform drawing. And you would listen to that and go, oh, okay, well, how's that going to help me with my purpose? But what it actually does is it starts to shift your energy into creating, as opposed to what we all can kind of fall victim into is just surviving and going through that same loop. But if we're sitting there and we're taking time out of that survival loop to create something, anything, we don't need to worry about commodifying that creation or it to even be what the end result is, but just the ritual of creating can really start to bring in this creative energy and this empowerment of I am a creator being, and it can activate a lot of remembrances for people of what it is that perhaps they're here to create or to have this space of insight and activation. And so, you know, in a lot of ancient tribes, the women were the weavers, and so when they were weaving baskets or jewelry or blankets, they weren't just sitting there weaving a blanket or a necklace. They were very intentionally weaving their intentions for what they wanted for reality, of what they wanted for the tribe, so that these baskets would be sacred talismans that would start to really weave the fabric of reality. And once I've started to learn more about that, it just fascinates me. And so that was why I mentioned the ritual before of the dreaming, because it's when we're in the dreaming that we're planting the seeds of what we experience in this waking dream.
So I want to dive into a different subject. Over the last few weeks, we've all been incredibly rocked in Australia and even more so in New Zealand with the attacks in Christchurch. And, you know, these kind of terrorist attacks are happening all over the world. I know that I very much felt that grief personally, and I also experienced that trauma in some ways energetically, in that I could feel that in the collective conscious.
Absolutely.
All over the world, there's war, crisis, terrorism, and these horrific events occurring. And I do think as human beings, we're all affected on some level. So with definitely all of that in mind, I have two questions. The first one is, how can soul-centered humans come together and shared purpose in order to assist the world to heal and to return to love?
Well, I think it's, you know, when something like that goes on, we all definitely feel it, definitely those that are aware and conscious. And I think that particular attack felt very differently to maybe some of the others, because it was, you know, this beautiful group of people really practicing their faith and in such a vulnerable, sacred, divine space. And that was when it happened. So for me, you know, I was definitely rocked and rattled by it. I think like so many people were as well. It can be really hard on our nervous systems as well. But in saying that, if we let ourselves just stay in the spiral of stress with it, then we all go into protection mode and almost block off the ability to resolve a lot of these issues, and it can create a lot more separation because we fall into fear, and fear creates that separation. So for me, it's always a reminder to anchor back into love. And so this is where my meditation practice of taking time out in solitude, of coming back and supporting my body and my nervous system to process that trauma or that stress and that fear, and to shift the frequencies. Because when we can stay anchored into our bodies and have gratitude and appreciation, it actually flicks ourselves into growth so that we can start to have resolution and creative insights coming through. But I think this is also where it is a really important time where a lot of these acts are coming because there's so much separation in the collective. And so the question is, well, how can we start to unify and heal the divides that are going on? And unfortunately, I think a lot of those divides, when I've been reflecting on it over the last couple of the weeks, is the internet and social media. We're all in these little bubbles where, you know, I scroll down my feed and I'm just surrounded by like-minded opinions. So I'm in this almost inflated love bubble. And so when something like that happens, it's really jarring where I'm like, oh, my God, this doesn't happen in my communities, or what's going on? Where are these people that are holding so much hate? Well, they're in their own bubbles where they're all feeding off each other. So I think the bigger questions is, well, how can we start to create more group environments, more spaces of unity where we can embrace diversity again, rather than it having to be, or this is my way, so everyone's got to conform to that. So I don't necessarily have the answers to that, but I think it's just that knowing that I need to always be aware not to go into fear and protection, to keep coming back to myself, to grounding, to going out in nature and just getting the perspective, so that I can focus on, okay, well, what is my purpose in the greater collective of how I can serve and support, knowing that I can't fix everything, but I can focus on what's going on in my life and being in service and kindness. And one of my things was, after that time, was when I was walking around my neighborhood, to make eye contact with everyone and to smile to everyone, because I was like, right, we've got to, you know, for me just to connect with people rather than us being in our bubbles on our phones all the time. And it was interesting because I went to my sister-in-law's just become an Australian citizen, and it was the first citizenship ceremony that I've ever been to. But it was beautiful because the mayor of the council that she's a part of, really, because it was like literally a couple of days after that attack, made a real clarification to everyone that was there of, you know, Australia's been built on migrants. Everyone here is a migrant unless you are an Indigenous Australian. So to honour that and to support that diversity of us coming together in a tribe rather than to feed into the separation. And it was really powerful.
Yeah, look, I love your point with regards to digital diversity, because I hadn't actually thought about it that way. And, you know, I have thought about the fact that algorithms are mean that we literally get fed back what we put in to digital platforms. So that part I had thought about with regards to the fact that a lot of my news feed is quite siloed, but I hadn't thought about it in reference to the fact that my experience of the digital world is not a diverse world. It's not a place really of inclusion, because it's a place where, by its very nature, where we're put into separate bubbles. And I hadn't really considered the influence of that. So I think that's a really interesting point that you make. And again, the importance of getting out into the real world and being part of our beautifully rich and diversive community, and connecting eye to eye and connecting, you know, with human beings in the real world is so profoundly important. you know, and I'm sure there's, you know, physiological effects in doing that as well. So
absolutely.
So look, as a closing question today, I want to talk to you about legacy, because I wholeheartedly believe that the energy of purpose and the creation of legacy are linked. So if you could summarize your story or your legacy into a few sentences, what would those sentences be?
Oh.
It's a big one.
It is. I feel that my purpose and my legacy is to help to raise consciousness on the earth at this time.
Well, I believe that you are doing that beautifully every day, every moment, and in every interaction that you have.
Oh, thank you, Beck.
Thank you so much for taking the time for joining me on Decoding Purpose. And I am sending you so much love and light.
Thank you. My absolute pleasure. It's been awesome.
I'm excited to announce a partnership that I am personally so passionate about. And that partnership is with Ambezi. Ambezi are a brand new tech platform, and they are connecting entrepreneurs and business people who have amazing stories to share with the next generation. So the way Ambezi works is it connects entrepreneurs with local schools and local universities, and the intention is to inspire, educate, and activate purpose and passion for the next generation. All you need to do to give 1 hour is log on to www.ambezi.com.